Okay, so welcome back to part two of the first content-based lecture of the course. Basically, what you just had in part number one is the backdrop, and all of the ideas there are essential to understanding classical aesthetics and classical styles in works of art. But now, what we're doing is we're looking at the first works of art that you'll be accountable for on quizzes, on summary essays, on discussions, and so forth. So, you don't need to memorize or even have at the top of your head the examples that I gave you last lecture. Now you do, right? Now you have to take those ideas that we just talked about and see how they fit with the works of art that are part of our class proper. So, we're going back to, again, the time period of neoclassicism with the reign of Louis XVI, and we're in France at this time, and the major artist, and all the artists that you see in these survey classes and in this class in particular are considered to be the greatest artist of their day. Now, we could get into a long discussion about who just determine that these are the greatest artists. But the way that this usually works is these are the artists that during their own age were considered to be the greatest artists of their time, and they had the greatest impact on on artists who came after them. That's why they end up in your textbooks. And without question, the most important artist of the end of the 18th, beginning of the 19th century in France, and frankly by extension in the world, because France was the cultural center, at least in Western Europe, of the arts, is Jacques-Louis David. Jacques-Louis David came through the academic system. He was taught in the French Royal Academy. Early in his career, he won the Prix de Rome, that coveted prize that all early artists were seeking to win. And then went on to be a darling, at least early on, of Louis XVI and the Royal Academy. However, as we'll see in the course of his career, during this very tumultuous time, Jacques-Louis David will get hooked up with the French Revolution. He's an active participant in the French Revolution, which of course is deposing the French monarchy. And then when that fails, because the first French Revolution really does fail in a lot of ways, and Napoleon takes power, he will become one of the court painters or imperial painters for Napoleon. So it's a pretty interesting career trajectory, and you'll see lots of changes in his art. But we start here with the work that you see on the screen to the right-hand side. And again, minimize my head if you want to see a larger image of this and just listen to me speak. What we see here is a work of art that he produced called The Oath of the Horatii, or Oath of the Sons of Horus, in 1780, let's see, what is this? 1784-85, at the bequest, or it was commissioned by what's known as the Grand Assembly of France. The Grand Assembly of France, I'm not going to get into all the ins and outs of the political system, but the Grand Assembly of France is one of the bodies of Parliament that was supposed to check the monarchical power, that was basically the aristocrats and upper classes and monarchy that were in charge of this. And they basically commissioned this work of art for him, and they probably had in mind a very particular subject or concept that they wanted him to get at. And we're going to use this as a kind of an early example of neoclassicism in France. So let's start with this part. The subject matter. Remember what subject matter is. It's on the one hand, at a really base level, when we say subject matter, we mean what do we see in the work of art, particularly in representational works of art. So, at a basic level, you'd say, well, the subject matter is four guys and, three women in an architectural setting with a couple of children and so on. But more specifically, the subject matter here is an ancient Roman story, which aligns it with the classical idea of having a grand subject, right? A historical subject and with a very important concept, which we'll get to in a minute. So let's start there. What is the subject? Now, for most of us today, we don't know a great deal about Roman or Greek or even maybe Christian religious subjects. And so it's not particularly familiar to us, but anyone at the time would have recognized this subject. And part of this is actually the reason that neoclassicism or classical aesthetics gets popularized again. I didn't mention this before, but it's worth knowing that in the middle of the 18th century, a couple of things happen that really invigorate or intensify an interest in classical history again. One of them is the discovery and systematic excavation of two Roman cities, Herculaneum and Pompeii, which had been completely covered by the eruption of Mount Vesuvius and preserved. Some of you know this. Pompeii, in particular, is familiar to a lot of people as a city, a Roman city that, because it was completely covered in the ashes of Mount Vesuvius, actually preserved the lives and what people were doing at this time when they were buried in volcanic ash. And during the 18th century, this was systematically excavated, and everyone was paying attention to the new archaeological discoveries that were being made at this time. Most of you are too old, or young, rather, to remember this, but when I was a kid, the tomb of King Tut, King Tutankhamun, all of the findings in that tomb, which had been discovered at the beginning, by the way, of the 20th century, went on a tour of the United States and Europe and so forth, and everyone got really excited about Egypt again. And the same thing was happening in Europe. Everyone got re-excited about classical times and Roman times and so forth. So that reinvigorated an interest in classicism. And along with that, if you were a member of the upper classes, it was almost compulsory that at some point in your life, usually during the end of your education, you went on what was known as the Grand Tour. And the Grand Tour was it's kind of like a contemporary foreign exchange program. You would travel throughout sites of Western Europe, in particular ancient Athens, and or not ancient, but Athens, and look at all the ancient things, or go to Rome and learn about Roman culture and learn Latin and learn all these stories. So everyone would have known this, and it was very much a part of their Western tradition to know about the history of classical Greece and Rome and so forth. So they would have known this subject, and it was very popular at the time. So the subject is this. In Roman history, so the stories go, there was a particular moment in time in which the Romans were locked in endless wars with their neighbors, the Albans. And again, these subjects are in your textbook, and they're also listed on your lecture guide. In this story, neither side could win. They're just basically a war of attrition. Each side goes into a battle, and maybe one side gets the upper hand, but no one's winning this battle. And it's dragging down society. And so each side decides, let's put an end to this all at once. And the way that we're going to do this, so the stories go, is that the Romans will pick their three greatest warriors, and the Albans will pick their three greatest warriors, and they'll go into hand-to-hand combat, and whichever side wins, wins the war. Right? So what is this all about then? What is the concept behind this grand subject matter? Well, the concept is being shown right here. What we witness is on the left-hand side of the painting, follow my cursor here, you see the three sons of Horus, and Horus himself is in the center, who is one of the main leaders of Rome at this time. And the three sons are pledging their obligation to Rome, to the state, to go into battle and do their best and try to win for Rome. While Horus, as an older man, is gripping together their swords, and we see this kind of oath of allegiance to Rome at this time. What is the concept then? Take a minute to think about this. The concept is one we still hear about today. The concept is to sacrifice your own immediate needs as a person for the greater benefit of society, or in this case, the state, Rome. Now, while this is pitched as a historical subject, remember, this happened in history, it's also meant to edify a contemporary public to their obligations to the state of France during a time period in which the French monarchy is under a lot of pressure to change the way that, you know, social stratification has worked up to this point, that everyone is supposed to help the French monarch, and the lower classes are saying, what's in it for us? And here we have a work of art commissioned by the Grand Assembly, who is by extension an arm of the monarchy, saying, you are supposed to dedicate yourself to the betterment of France, even if that means going against things that are better for you. The concept is self-sacrifice for the benefit of the state. And you can see how that would be important during this time period in France, even though it's a historical subject, right? So that's the basic subject matter. That's the basic story. It's why it's a grand subject. And it's the moral lesson that is being taught here. Now let's talk about the stylistics here. What is the focal point? Where does your eye look and why does it look there? And if you notice, all of the implied lines of this work of art, everywhere that everyone looks goes directly to these swords. That is the focal point, right in the center of the picture. Further all, we see these sharp swords being held by the naked hand of Horus, the father. What does that say to you? Well, it's dangerous, right? It's something that is, you know, he's gripping these sharp swords with his hand. Someone's going to die here, but they're going to die for the better good, right? So our focal point's here, and it fits perfectly within the concept of the work. Let's go one step further. If you have looked at your introductory chapter, you'll know by looking at the floor tiles on this work that all of the lines of these floor tiles are receding to a central point. This is called central point perspective, which is a perfect way of creating the illusion of three dimensions, but it's also a perfect space. And it's all pointing to this focal point as well. If you follow these lines up, they all go to the same point right here, focusing on the focal point. Why is it ideal? Why is it perfect? Look at all the bodies of Horus's sons. They are all made out of canons of proportions. They're all perfect bodies, ideal bodies, meant to show you, again, these ideas we covered in the last lecture, that a perfect body is a representation of divinity or truth and goodness. And in this case, they're all the same body based upon the same classical system of proportions to say these people are all good and true because they're ideal or beautiful, right? Further, if we go on this, notice how they're all arranged very systematically as very firm bases, kind of triangular or pyramidal composition to hold these bodies in place, and that they all mimic each other like a perfect kind of harmony of bodies serving the same purpose. That is all ideal as well. We go another step forward. You see in Jacques-Louis David's work, a clear separation of a foreground, as if all of these figures in the foreground are on a stage, and then a middle ground. Jacques-Louis David's big kind of innovation in the arts is to not even have a background in most of his work, so as to focus our attention on the things that matter the most in the foreground. If we go on to things like balance and symmetry, it's not a symmetrical composition, but it is very balanced. If you split it down the middle, you've got weight over here of three bodies and a number of women's bodies over here. You see three archways in the background, kind of perfectly symmetrical to one another. Right? If you look at the colors aren't too intense. There's not a lot of vibrant colors like you saw in the Rococo period immediately before this. They're primarily analogous colors in here, aren't they? Now let's go on from that to talk about some other things going on in this work. If you're wondering, well, why doesn't Horus go into the battle on his own? Well, look at Horus. He's too old. He's tilting back a little bit more than his sons are. This leg in particular, his left leg looks like it's twisted a little bit, like he's not quite supporting himself with the same strength of his sons. he's not the best man for the job in this situation. And then we get another juxtaposition, one that you'll read about next week, but one that I want to emphasize here. Who are these women? And notice how they're represented differently than the sons of Horus. The women are, and again, I don't need you to remember the names of these people, but know the basic idea. Camilla here, the blonde, is one of the sisters of, and the daughter of Horus here, sisters of one of these brothers. And she is slated to be married to one of the Alban warriors who is going to go into battle with these men. And so she's very emotionally distraught because she's either going to lose a brother or she's going to lose her potential husband. And Sabina over here, the dark-haired woman, inversely, is slated to be married to one of the sons of Horus, but her family comes from the Alban family that they're going to go into battle with. So she's going to lose someone as well. And these kids are looking on being emotional as well. What I'm getting at is that we have a juxtaposition between something that is very important in classical arts, which is rationality on the left-hand side of our picture. These are people who know that they very well might die, but their rational impulse, their rational thinking leads them to believe that it is better for them to sacrifice their own personal, you know, well-being for the betterment of the state, versus the women over here who are aligned with emotionality. They're sad. Their bodies don't have the same kind of stature as the men over here. They're very much kind of indulging in their emotions. Now, during this time period, it was a firm belief, and I still hear the stereotype today, that men are rational and women are emotional. And so in this case, like with all art, Jacques-Louis David is following the belief systems of his time in which emotional women juxtaposed against the rational powers of man are meant to show you the proper way to be. More rational rather than emotional over here. Now, when he created this work of art, it got a lot of awards when it was shown in the Royal Academy, and it was very closely aligned with monarchical ideas. But later on, when the French Revolution starts in 1789 with the storming of the Bastille, a little prison in Paris that held primarily political prisoners, Jacques-Louis David becomes a member of what was known as the Jacobin Party. Now, the Jacobin Party was led by a man by the name of Maximilien Robespierre. And if you've ever learned anything about the French Revolution, you'll know that what they did was they deposed the king and Marie Antoinette, and they tried to get rid of the French monarchy. They even tried to get rid of religion because they thought it was a way that the state controlled people, and they tried to put into place a more democratic system, but they did it in a really, shifty way. They killed off, through the so-called Reign of Terror and the use of the guillotine, anyone who was in opposition to them, and this led to a lot of problems along the line. But Jacques-Louis David, as a painter, participated in that French Revolution. We know this because his signature is on over 500 execution orders during that time period. And along with painting scenes that were beneficial to the French Revolution, he painted scenes that were meant to memorialize, in particular, his friend and great leader, Jean-Paul Marat, who was killed in this, and becomes very closely associated with the French Revolution. So much so that during the 1790s, this painting was forgotten to have originally been patronized by the monarchy and was conceived to be an early call to arms for the French people. In other words, they reinterpreted this painting as saying to them, every one of you French citizens, if you want a better society, need to sacrifice yourself for the betterment of France. And now it didn't mean the French monarchy, now it meant in the service of the revolution. If we look at this up close, I just want to show you a couple of details. There are those perfect idealized bodies of the The sons of Horus. Remember, perfect idealized bodies going all the way back to Polykleitos' Doryphoros were symbolic of truth and goodness because they were beautiful. If we look at the women over on the other side, there's quite a difference, isn't there? They're crumpled, they are kind of turned into themselves, they're pushed a little bit back away from the foreground. They're very emotionally inclined. That is not the way that he wanted people to respond. Very briefly, I want to show you another early work by Jacques-Louis David, very similar on the subject of the death of Socrates. Once again, we have a profound human subject. Once again, it is on the same type of concept as we just saw. For those of you who don't know, Socrates, who was the teacher of Plato and the original of the great Greek philosophers for a lot of people, ended up being accused for basically corrupting the youth of Athens, and he was given a choice to either be exiled, which for most Greeks was like the worst thing that could happen, or to commit suicide by his own hand, which he chose by drinking hemlock in this case. And in this work, what we see is Socrates taking from one of his companions the cup of hemlock that he will drink to commit suicide, and pointing up to probably the realm of forms, or pointing up in a way that says, this is what I believe in and I will not take it back, I would rather die, while all of his followers look on in lament over his decision. Now there's a couple things to point out about this. First of all, remember, we're in classical times, so classical subjects taken from Greece and Rome are very, very prevalent, and here we have another classical story. Number two, look at Socrates. I'm not sure how old he's supposed to be here, but he looks incredibly fit, doesn't he? This is an old man who's taking care of himself. But more importantly, what this is saying with that perfect idealized body, even if it is older, is that Socrates is good and true, so we represent him ideally. Now, in this case, we don't have women in the story, but in order to emphasize Socrates' rational decision, that he would rather stand up for his beliefs than cower and live, we see, instead of women, we see all of his followers lamenting his death so as to make us even more aware of his rational decision-making. Like with most of the lectures throughout this quarter, you will see me focus very heavily on one work of art, such as Jacques-Louis David's Oath of the Horatii, and then give you sometimes secondary works of art that are perhaps less important to continue on talking about big ideas or give you another example of a big work of art. But it is the main works of art, like the Oath of the Horatii, that you really have to keep your eye on when it comes to tests, the quizzes rather, or summary essays. These secondary works of art are meant to show you there are many, many works of art that I could be talking about that continue the same ideas. But because we've got a limited, you know, period of class, these will be treated a little bit more quickly. When Jacques-Louis David becomes a member of the Jacobin Party and starts working under Maximilien Robespierre, he makes a friend, a very close friend, by the name of Jean-Paul Marat. Jean-Paul Marat was, for lack of a better word, the minister of propaganda for the Jacobin Party during the French Revolution. He was a man of letters who suffered from a skin disease, probably some form of eczema, that necessitated that he oftentimes took medicinal baths even while doing his business. Now, if you were a member of the Jacobin Party or the French Revolution, Jean-Paul Marat was a really important character, someone that you liked a lot because he furthered the cause of the French Revolution. But if you weren't a member of the French Revolution, or you sided with other components of the French Revolution, or even monarchical powers, he was a horrible person. I mean, he used every means at his disposal in order to further the goals of the French Revolution. He, you know, pointed fingers at particular political leaders and made up stories or exacerbated or, overstated causes for why they should be executed and so forth. He sometimes called together different parties of people in one space that he knew wouldn't get along to foment discord and lead to the, again, furthering the goals of the French Revolution. He was, you know, if he was on your side, he was a good guy, and if he was not on your side, he was someone you totally hated. And what happened during the French Revolution in the 1790s, early on in the 1790s, is that a woman who was really against some of the extremes of the French Revolution, her name was Charlotte Corday, assassinated him. Now, once he was assassinated, Jacques-Louis David decided to memorialize him in this famous work called The Death of Marat. Now, The Death of Marat is not straightforward a classical work of art. It is something that Jacques-Louis David did in order to memorialize his great friend and to memorialize the cause of the French Revolution. Now, the subject is contemporary. This is a fairly new thing in classical arts. More often than not, classical arts take subjects out of ancient times, even if their parables or moral lessons are meant to be for contemporary publics. Furthermore, one of the reasons this isn't classical is he hasn't really perfectly idealized this body, nor has he, you know, put in any of the traditional kind of symbolism. In other words, what I'm saying is that this work is a little bit of an anomaly for Jacques-Louis David, but let's go through what it's all about. When Charlotte Corday sought to assassinate Jean-Paul Marat, what she did was she sent him a letter that said, "Hey, I'm a member of the French Revolution and I've suffered horribly. Can you help me out?" Now, according to every historical record we have, Jean-Paul Marat totally did ignored her. He didn't give her an audience to talk to her. In this picture, however, what we see is Marat holding the letter that supposedly Charlotte Corday sent him, and we can read it in the original painting. It says, "Hi, my name's Charlotte Corday. It's only my great, difficulties that lead me to ask for your help," and so forth. The reason that this is important is because, of course, Jacques-Louis David has changed the truth of history in order to make Marat look like a good guy. Like, he heard from a woman in the French Revolution that she was suffering, and he allowed her to come see him. Now, he's lying in a bathtub because, as I said before, he suffered from a skin ailment. And so this painting makes it seem like he was in his bathtub suffering from a skin ailment. He got this letter, he gave admittance to Charlotte Corday, and she came in and stabbed him to death. The truth is that he didn't respond to that letter, and she sneaked in through a back door in order to gain admittance and stabbed him to death. But let's go on to the complexities of this work of art. What is it saying to us? Number one, you wouldn't know this unless you took the history of art. But Jean-Paul Marat lying here with his hand over the edge, bleeding on a white cloth out of a wound in his upper chest, but very close to his side, makes him look a lot like depictions through the ages of Jesus Christ, who, when hanging on the cross, was stabbed in the side and oftentimes bled on his white loincloth. So there is what we call in art history an allusion, ALL. USION, meaning it alludes to something else. In this case, it makes Jean-Paul Marat look like Jesus. In other words, what it's saying to us is just like D Jesus died for the betterment of mankind, so Jean-Paul Marat died for the betterment of mankind by making that visual correlation between the two. It also says that, and this was a big worry of a lot of people at the time, when the French Revolution and the Jacobean Party came to power, one of the things they did is they took all of the property of the monarchy and of the Catholic Church in France, and they took all that property and they tried to redistribute it. And people thought, well, they're probably just keeping it for themselves. But we see here, Jean-Paul Marat's surroundings are pretty meager. His table is literally a board placed upon over a bathtub with a piece of green felt over it, And his end table, so to speak, is a crate turned up on its side, which he uses to write on. And you see his quill and his ink here on that. So it's saying, no, 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 he's not getting rich off that. This goes even further. You can probably barely make it out, but on the edge of this crate is another letter that Jean-Paul Marat had been writing, supposedly to another member of the French Revolution who had lost a number of children in the cause of the French Revolution. And what he's saying, and you can read this on the letter if you were to see it firsthand, is here's some money for you, basically. Sorry that you lost people. It's a good cause. Here's some money for you. And on that letter is the paper money of the French Revolution, which is known as an assignat, which is on your lecture guide. An assignat, again, just like, it's like what we would say in the United States, we call it a dollar, right? And in England, they call it a pound. In France, they called it an assignat. An assignat was an early form of paper money used for the French Revolution, but we may have forgotten this today. Early on, when people printed paper money, that money had to have some kind of a value associated with it. So all of the value of the paper money, the assignat, printed by the French Revolution, the value of that was secured against all the properties that they had taken from the French monarchy and aristocracy and the French Catholic Church. So in a way, what this is saying is, because everyone would have recognized it, this paper money is a way of redistributing the wealth that formerly only the monarchy and the clergy and so forth had to people in need. If we go another step further on this, you'll notice that, and I'm gonna get us in here close on this, and you'll see another detail in a moment. There's that assignat up close. In the real painting, what you would notice is the light that goes across Marat is very soft lighting. It makes it almost sounds like soft music meant to make us feel sad for his death. But the light that hits this letter by Charlotte Corday is actually raking light, and it picks up every little crinkle in the paper and makes it sound like, you know, visually sound like something horrible happening. After the French Revolution, Jacques-Louis David was imprisoned for almost a year for his participation, but he was gotten out of prison partially at the help of his wife, who was very well connected in the world, and partially because this rising new leader, Napoleon Bonaparte, who took advantage of the really difficult situation politically in France with the monarchy collapsing and the French Revolution collapsing in order to establish an empire in France. Napoleon wanted him to be his painter. He knew, Napoleon did, that painters could really serve propagandistically to make him even more important than he already was. So Jacques-Louis David got out on the other side of the French Revolution and hooked his star to Napoleon Bonaparte and became what is known as an imperial painter or court painter for Napoleon. What this means is that the painter's job was basically to make Napoleon look really good and to associate him with the values of progress and things that people of the time would have said, hey, this is what we want from a great leader. And this is one painting that is an example of this. There are multiple different versions of this painting, all usually referred to as Napoleon crossing the Saint Bernard. The Saint Bernard is a pass in the Alps, and it refers to Napoleon's campaigns to take over parts of Germany and Italy and all the way up to Russia, where of course he failed eventually. And what we see here is something that is typical kind of glorification of a great leader, and you should know some of the symbolism. Napoleon is sitting astride a rearing white charger. Now that horse doesn't necessarily need to be white, but the association of great leaders with horses, and if you've ever seen what's called an equestrian monument, you'll be familiar with this, goes all the way back to the ancient Romans. And the symbolism is really straightforward. It goes like this: a great leader leads his horse in the same way that he leads his people. So here's this horse rearing up and bucking and wild-eyed as it's being forced to cross these mountain passes. But look at Napoleon. He looks completely comfortable and confident, and he's pointing out over the pass to say, you know, I've got this all handled. Secondly, in the foreground here, follow my cursor again, you will see the names Bonaparte, Hannibal, and Carolmagne, which is Charlemagne. Bonaparte, of course, is the last name of Napoleon. Hannibal and Charlemagne were two other conquerors from history who had led armies off to conquer parts of Europe in the service of Christianity and in the service of a better Europe. So what Napoleon's doing here is associating his conquest with these earlier great leaders. Now, of course, all of this is historical fiction. We know for a fact that Napoleon was a really, really smart guy, and riding a horse over treacherous mountain passes would have been idiocy. Instead, he rode over these passes on the back of a donkey or a mule, but that's not quite the same picture, is it? So we associate, or we make a kind of historical fiction here to make Napoleon look like a great leader and associate him with other great leaders of the past. The final work by Jacques-Louis David that I want to show you is a giant mural-sized painting known as Le Sacre. And I just want, and it's called The Coronation of Josephine sometimes as well. I just want to briefly point out the way that paintings, of course, make people look better than they actually were. When Napoleon was crowned emperor after the turn of the century, so in the early 1800s, of course, the way that old emperors were crowned was they invited the Pope in and the Pope crowned them. Stories have it that Napoleon didn't allow the Pope to crown him, but crowned himself. Now, it's not quite clear that that's true, but what we do know is that after being crowned emperor, whether he did it himself or allowed the Pope to do it, he took the task of the Pope. And instead of allowing the Pope to crown his empress, Josephine, he crowned her himself, which we see happening here. That's a way for Napoleon to say to the world, I'm more important than anyone, both in terms of military and state and in terms of religion. There will be no man above me. The Pope's not going to crown my empress. And so we see that occurring here. All the people in this picture, which is huge, are portraits of the most important people of the time, which is common. And we even see in a loge, which is a little opera box, and all of this is taking place, by the way, in the great cathedral of Notre Dame de Paris in the middle of Paris. We see his mother and Jacques-Louis David himself over here next to the cross looking on. Now, it's all a historical fiction again to some degree. His mom, for whatever reason, didn't even attend, so he's kind of like photoshopped his mom into the picture. And the Pope over here, Pius II, who is none too happy about Napoleon, crowning his own empress, probably didn't extend his blessing. But in this picture, we see the Pope raising his hand and blessing the union. Because after all, if you're a painter, you do what your emperor asks you to do. So here's the Pope raising his hand and blessing. And here's Napoleon doing this action. Now, the Pope wasn't happy about this, but again, if you're the painter, you get to do whatever you want. And he's doing it at the bequest of Napoleon. So I'm going to pause here just for a second. I'll be right back. So, Mac, wanted to move over now away from France, even though there are many other artists of the neoclassical tradition that could be brought into this story, to talk about what's going on concurrently in England, or Great Britain as it was known. And here, remember, you had a reading by Sir Joshua Reynolds. The French Royal Academy starts first, but a little over 100 years later, the English start their own Royal Academy of the Arts based upon the same sets of ideas and classical aesthetics that the French did in order to compete with the French. They're constantly in competition with them. And Sir Joshua Reynolds, in that reading, it's kind of like a simpler version of Poussin's reading, says much the same thing. Basically, what he says is that great art comes from the classical tradition, and what your job is as an artist is not to, and this is, I think, something really important, at least for the idea of classicism. What your job is as an artist is not to revolutionize art. Don't think that you're as great as Michelangelo and Poussin and so forth. What your job is as an artist is to basically stand on the shoulders of giants, to continue the traditions of earlier artists rather than revolutionize those ideas and learn from the great masters of the past. Now, Sir Joshua Reynolds, in his own work, which you see here on the screen in front of you, primarily did portraits because, frankly, England didn't have the same infrastructure as France. And the way to make money as an artist was always through portraits. So he created portraits of these great aristocratic people. And we're going to talk about that a little bit. It's not a particularly classical work of art, frankly, that you're looking at here in front of you. This is a work called Mrs. Siddons, which is the name of the sitter, as a tragic muse. And simply put, all I want to say about this work before we get to our main example of English grand manner painting. See, the English called their neoclassical style grand manner painting. Is in terms of gender. Gender will be one of those thematics that I'm very interested in, so I want you to be thinking about this quite a bit throughout this quarter. We live in an age now in which we have multiple different media showing us kind of examples of what we're supposed to be, depending upon what gender we are and what is esteemed of our gender. But back in the day, art was the way that people modeled their behavior and kind of represented their stereotypes of what each gender was supposed to be. When we were looking at Jacques-Louis David's The Oath of the Horatii, you saw some of that, right? Men are supposed to be rational and strong and go out there and do things and change the world. Women are, by nature, more emotional and frankly, are weaker, is the way that they thought of it, and are mainly esteemed, and this is key, for their appearance, for how they look. They're the ones who inspire other people to do great things. They are the woman behind the man. So here we have this great aristocratic woman, Mrs. Siddons, and the way that she is being depicted as is as completely beautiful, as an inspiration, right? The muse for the creation of classical arts, including this painting. Behind her in the background, you see personifications of the theatrical arts, tragedy and comedy. And in the foreground, you see her looking askance off to the side, allowing us to contemplate our beauty, her beauty, so that we can be inspired to create great art. And this is very much the way that women wanted themselves depicted. The thing that was most esteemed about women through the ages was their beauty. And so over and again, in portraits and elsewhere, women are represented as beautiful. And we'll get to some of the complexities of that next week. Here's another example of Sir Joshua Reynolds' work, another portrait, in this case, Lady Sarah Bunbury sacrificing to the three graces. Now again, Lady Sarah Bunbury was one of the beauties of her age. But in this case, what we're showing her do, and this is partially classic, is sacrifice or give some kind of offering to the three graces. The three graces, for those of you who don't know, are basically attendants of the goddess of beauty, Venus. They're usually represented in sculpture as three beautiful young women. And here she is basically saying, yeah, I know I'm beautiful, but I want to be even more beautiful. That's what I aspire to, even greater beauty. And one of the things that's most interesting about this portrait is you see the young girl in the background helping her in her offering by pouring essential oils into an offering dish, learning from this older woman what she should aspire to be as well. Beautiful. Rather than, let's say, a contributor to society or someone who goes out there and writes beautiful letters or, frankly, creates beautiful art, a woman's role was to inspire the creation of beautiful paintings. Now, the artist who ends up being the exemplar of grand manner or classical aesthetics in England was actually born in the United States, and his name is Benjamin West. He will go on to be the second president of the English Royal Academy, but at this stage in his career, what you're looking at is a work that is a masterpiece. Now, today we throw around the term masterpiece to refer to any great work of art, but back in the day, a masterpiece was the work of art that an artist created at the end of his tutelage, his being a student, in order to show the world that he was ready to go off and be a master artist in his own right. In other words, when you got done with your education, you created kind of the best work of art that you could create to show the world how good you were and how you were a master in your own right. This work's title is long and ponderous, but in a way, that's important to tell you again about how everyone of this time would have understood Greek and Roman history and would have been familiar with the subject. The title of this is Agrippina Landing at Brundisium with the Ashes of Germanicus. Now, I presume that no one in this class knows what this refers to, so I'll give you the subject. And it's a subject, by the way, that Sir Benjamin West actually consulted with the Archbishop of Canterbury, thinking about what would be an appropriate subject for his masterwork and what would teach the English public the right moral attitudes during his own time. You see, in ancient classical times, Agrippina was the wife of Germanicus. And Germanicus was one of those great Roman generals who got so popular through his military exploits that the leader of the time, Tiberius, got really worried about him coming back into Rome and taking his power. And so he probably conspired to have him assassinated. Now, once he's assassinated, as was in keeping with Roman tradition, he was cremated on a pyre, and his wife, Agrippina, brought his ashes back to be buried in Rome. Now, here's where this thing gets complex. The moral message here has to do with what Agrippina did next. In history, Agrippina was an incredibly viable widow, right? She was married to Germanicus. In Roman times, being remarried wasn't a big thing. She had the sympathy of his legions of soldiers. She had the sympathy of the Roman public. She was incredibly wealthy, and everyone wanted to marry her after her husband died, and she refused to be remarried. And that's the moral message here. It's what we call conjugal fidelity. She would remain faithful to her husband even after he died. Now, the two children who are with her, follow my cursor, are on the one hand, Agrippina the Younger, who will grow up to be the mother of the great and fairly infamous Roman leader Nero. And the other one is Caligula, who goes on to do all kinds of messed up things. If you haven't learned about Caligula, do a Google search on this guy. But in any case, the message here, and you see the focal point, here they are all in the center, is Agrippina will teach her belief systems to her children. Apparently, she failed with this one, but she succeeded with her daughter because her daughter will go on to tell the future emperor Nero he can't remarry. Even though he wanted to divorce his wife and remarry, and everyone would have known this story. So she is extending her values about remaining faithful to your husband to the Roman public. And by extension, the idea is that during this time in England, where there was some question about people being faithful to their husbands and wives, this moral lesson would be taught to them. So the work is completely classical in its subject matter. It's classical in the way that it's represented, right? We have a clear foreground, then we have a space and a middle ground where you see this architecture in a deep background. The work is basically symmetrical. If you split it down the middle, you have equal weight and bodies on each side of this. All of the bodies in this work are based upon classical canons of proportions to make them perfectly ideal, but it goes even further than that. If you're looking at the central grouping, which is the focal point of all these figures around Agrippina, you'll notice they're all painted in gray tones. This term, which is on your lecture guide, is known as grisaille, or painting in gray tones, and it's meant to make these figures look like sculpture. Now, I don't need you to remember the specifics of this, but in this case, the general idea is that these figures are actually taken from an old Roman sculpture known as the Aura Pacis Augusti. It's a sculpture that was created for that leader that you saw in the first lecture, Octavian Augustus, and it promoted family values in old Roman times. And what the artist has done is basically copied many of the figures with slight modification, painted them in gray tone so that people would get the allusion back to this earlier sculpture and said, "I'm promoting family values." In the background, to make this even more classical, what we see here in this building is an actual representation of a reconstruction of a Roman monument known as the Palaces of Diocletian in Spalatro. Again, I don't need you to remember it's Diocletian's palaces, but it is really important because for, in particular, the English, it was important to represent things as accurately as you could. Archaeological accuracy was seen as truth, so trying to represent an actual Roman building and an actual, in this case, Roman sculpture in the foreground was one of the ways that they promoted the idea of truth. Benjamin West's most revolutionary work was this one. This is a work that was on a contemporary subject, on the Seven Years' War in the United States during the colonial period. In the United States, we more often than not know of this as the French Indian Wars, in which both the French and the English, in order to secure their territorial, aspirations in the United States, used Native American groups to help this kind of colonial war between the two nations. The battle that we're seeing here, which is in a way a memorial to this great English general, General Wolfe, is the Battle of Quebec, in which the English actually won this battle, but at the moment that they win this battle, General Wolfe is fatally wounded and is dying here. Now, the revolutionary part of this work I'm going to save for a moment. What I want to talk is about now is the classical component of this work. We see once again a very classical moral message. It's the sacrifice of a great leader who is dying here for the betterment of England in this case. He's dying, but notice that no one shows great emotion because remember, in the classical tradition, being stoic or allowing your rational powers to reign was more important than showing emotional responses to things. There's a very clear focal point. Notice how the implied lines of every single figure in this, everyone's looking at him, point to General Wolfe. The light source shines on General Wolfe in the center here, making him the focal point. Even more importantly, General Wolfe once again looks very suspiciously like any number of depictions of Jesus after being taken down off of his cross, thus making the allusion once again to Jesus. He, just like Jesus, has sacrificed himself for the betterment of England, right? Now, you could keep going on with this work. There are a ton of things to talk about, but the big revolutionary quality of this work, which might surprise a ton of you, is that what was considered to be problematic about this work by contemporary audience is that it wasn't timeless enough. It was a very specific battle, and all of the characters are dressed in contemporary clothing. Benjamin West actually had models in his studio who were wearing the appropriate clothing and copied them. And if you're saying, well, what the heck else would he have done, right? What was he supposed to do? Of course, he's got to represent them in contemporary clothing. The answer was he was supposed to represent them according to classical times to make them more timeless and universal and kind of appeal to all ages in togas or in something that would have looked very classical. And even Sir Joshua Reynolds and the king of the time, King George III, publicly denounced Benjamin West's use of contemporary clothing here. Now, a year later, when the public weighed in and they were really interested and loved this work and loved that he used contemporary clothing, both of those people, Sir Joshua Reynolds and George III, would publicly apologized to Benjamin West, but this was a revolution to show them in contemporary clothing. The last thing that I want to talk about in respect to this work is this character in the foreground off to the left-hand side. This is a Mohawk warrior who may or may not have been supporting the English here. It's a kind of historical fiction. But we're going to come across the representation of Native Americans in our class when we look at, in particular, 19th century American landscape painting. And here's an early example of representing Native Americans as the noble savage. I'm sure most of you have heard this term before. The noble savage was one of the earliest ways that Europeans represented Native Americans. And the idea is this. When you hear that term, what was meant to be referenced by noble savage is an idea that was actually taken from a French philosopher, Jean-Jacques Rousseau, and slightly modified. You see, Jean-Jacques Rousseau once said that all people are born into the world innately noble, by which he meant we're all born into the world good. And then over the course of time, civilization and our interactions with other people can corrupt us. Now, in terms of the Native American, this was slightly modified to say Native Americans are, in essence, good or noble, but they need to be taught the right way. They need to be acculturated. They need to be taught our way of doing things, because it was presumed that Native Americans in all traditional societies were at a lower level on the evolutionary scale of humanity. And so the belief system went, they're innately noble, but we need to teach them. We need to teach them our way of thinking, our way of government, our way of interacting socially, and in particular, our form of religion, Christianity, to make them good citizens in the world. And here we see the Native American with his hand on his chin, which is a symbol of thinking, contemplating the model action of this leader who has died for his state and thus learning from the white Americans. Now, don't get me wrong, this is super problematic, right? To believe that these Native peoples didn't have their own belief systems, their own religions, their own particular way of interacting in the world that was just as good as Europeans. You know, they didn't believe that at this time period. They also used this idea of the noble savage in order to justify their colonization of North and South America at this time, thinking that we need to teach them, they're like children, thus it is our obligation, even our God-given duty, to teach them the right way of doing things. Very briefly, I just wanted to show you one work by, well, a couple of works by a woman artist in England at this time. In the classical tradition, women artists are few and far in between. And part of this is because women weren't allowed into the Royal Academies at the same rate as men. They were presumed not to be great artists in the same way as men. But even more importantly, there were certain kinds of presumptions about women's morality that stopped them from becoming great artists. One of the big ones being, which you'll read about to some degree, is that women weren't allowed to practice painting or drawing from live nude models because it was seen to be inappropriate for a woman to see a nude man. And learning to study the nude body and paint it accurately was fundamental to being an artist in the classical tradition. But even more importantly for this artist, Angelica Kauffman, who was intensely trained in Europe and studied in Rome and knew all the great people, of the time period and was really well accomplished, was that women weren't understood to be as well in tune with the subjects that were seen as high subjects as men. Battle scenes were seen to be something that only a man could understand. Obviously, the nude was something only a man was able to study from. Women were understood to have a kind of different aspect in the world. But Angelica Kauffman knew this. And so when she worked in the English Royal Academy, she painted more often than not subjects like this. This is a work that's called Cornelia Pointing to Her Children as Her Treasures, or Cornelia, Mother of the Gracchi. Now it comes from, again, a classical subject, Cornelia was considered to be the mother of two really great political reformers, Gaius Gracchus here and Tiberius. Now, Tiberius, of course, assassinates Germanicus, so I'm not sure how great of a reformer he was. But the story goes this way, and it was all an anecdote that everyone would have heard about. Cornelia was invited to a friend of hers' house, and we're presumptively in her friend's house, and her friend takes out all of her latest jewelry and says, "Look at all this beautiful jewelry I have. Where are your jewels?" And Cornelia, as the great mother, points to her children and says, "These are my treasures. These are what I emphasize in my life." In other words, this work reflects the societal values of its time, in which the greatest kind of impact women had on the world were to be raising accomplished good men rather than leaders in their own right. And this is the type of work that she used to make herself famous. Now, I want to, emphasize that she probably knew this was expected of us, and frankly, having read enough of her letters, she railed against these societal views, which is why every once in a while they show up in her art, and I just wanted to show you this work that I think is very funny. This is Angelica Kauffman's work called Zeuxis Selecting Models for His Picture of Helen of Troy. And once again, it's a classical story. Zeuxis was a famous Greek painter who none of his work survived because all the Greek paintings deteriorated over the ages. But the stories had it coming through history that Zeuxis once painted the most beautiful painting of Helen of Troy. And Helen of Troy is, for those of you who don't know, the woman who basically caused the Trojan War because Paris fell in love with her and stole her away from the Greeks, who then went to get her back from Troy. She was the most beautiful in the woman in the world. She was a demigod, half born of Zeus and half born of a mortal woman, Leda. And stories have it that the way that Zeuxis painted Helen was to invite beautiful women to his studio and then select parts of these beautiful women to comprise his painting. In other words, one woman had a beautiful face or beautiful lips or beautiful nose, another a beautiful arm or beautiful legs or breasts or whatever it was, and he would just paint little parts of each one of them and then put them into a composite. That's one of the ways that artists created ideals. In this picture, here's Zeuxis in the middle, looking at all these beautiful women. Well, this is the funny part. This is a portrait of Angelica Kauffman. While he is looking at the beauty, she is stealing his paintbrushes and his paints for her own artistic enterprise. So we're going back to France now here briefly. I wanted to show you some classical sculptures and again emphasize a couple of ideas that we've already talked about before. This is Antonio Canova's work, and what we're looking at here is a sculpture of the sister of Napoleon Bonaparte, whose name is Paulina Borghese. Now, Napoleon's sister Paulina was actually married off to a famous Italian family, the Borghese family, who had a ton of money that they could give to Napoleon, so she's kind of a pawn for the politics of the time, and she was a great beauty and a little bit of an independent. And she invited the greatest sculptor of the time, Antonio Canova, who worked primarily out of Italy, but he was part of the French court as well, to create a portrait of her as Venus or the victorious Venus. Now, many of you might think, wow, this must have been really risque that Paulina Borghese has herself depicted partially nude here. But everyone at the time would have known that this isn't actually Paulina Borghese's body. It's only her face or her head put on the body of something that is an idealized Venus form. And once again, like the works of Sir Joshua Reynolds, this is one of the ways that women wanted to have themselves represented as the most beautiful woman of their time, as being almost as beautiful as the great, beautiful goddess Venus here. Here it is from the back. This is all marble. It's all carved out of beautiful crystalline marble. Here it is, looking at it from the feet forward. Nice juxtaposition, right? So this is actually a depiction of her brother Napoleon. And in this case, Napoleon is playing the personification of the Greek and Roman god of war. In Roman times, this god's name is Mars, and in Greek times, his name was Ares, the god of war. And this work is called Napoleon as Mars the Peace Bringer. What this is meant to emphasize, again, is very propagandistic. It's meant to say to people that Napoleon is only trying to conquer Western Europe because he wants to bring peace and order and prosperity to all people by unifying them. It's an idea you still hear tossed around in the military, although I think we're a little bit more skeptical today. He holds in one hand, his left hand to our right, a symbol of his power to rule the world. It's what's known as a fasces, and we'll come across this term again in a moment. In his other hand, in his right hand, off to the left-hand side, he's holding in his hand a sphere, and on that sphere is the winged goddess of victory of Greek times known as Nike. So it's a symbol of victory. He's also represented completely nude and totally idealized. Can you guess why? And the answer is just like we saw back there with that sculpture of Octavian Augustus, the Augustus Prima Porta. He's made ideal because he is godlike. He's in the image of God. He is perfect and good and true, and he's going to be able to go out and accomplish all these great things. So, what's the difference here? Think about this. Woman aligned with beauty and appearance, man with activity, what they can do, what they can achieve in the world. Very much a reflection of the societal views of the time. One simple work, again by Antonio Canova, I just wanted to show you a couple of examples of this without going into much detail. This is his sculpture of the Three Graces. They're just attendants of the goddess Venus, they are personifications of beauty. Frankly, it's an easy way for an artist who is primarily producing for a heterosexual male patron, images of beautiful women who can be seen from all views. You get a little bit of a frontal view, a side view, a butt view, and so forth. So it's, very much in keeping with that idea of creating beauty for a male audience. The work of Antonio Canova that I want to spend the most time on, or at least kind of alert you to, because it's such a gorgeous work, is this one, which is basically life size. All of these are. This is a work called Cupid and Psyche. Cupid and Psyche is again a very classical subject matter. It comes from classical mythology. Some of you will have heard this story before, and for others, I have a lot of fun telling you about Greek myths because I think they're great. In this story, if you don't know, Cupid, or Eros as he was known in Greek times, is the son of Aphrodite, or Venus, as she's known in Roman times, the goddess of beauty. And in Greek times, Eros is a beautiful youth, totally beautiful. And of course, we know him mostly through artistic representations of a kind of Renaissance fat little cherub figure flying around indiscriminately shooting people with these arrows. And those arrows inflame their lust. Well, the story here goes like this. Psyche was a beautiful mortal woman, so beautiful that women of her time started saying to each other, "Wow, Psyche's so beautiful. She's just as beautiful as Venus or Aphrodite." Now, if you don't know already, the Greek gods are intensely jealous and they don't like it when mortals compare themselves to them. And she gets pretty jealous of Psyche. And so, what she determines to do, in at least some of the stories, is to seek retribution against Psyche. And the way that she initially plans to do this is send down her son, Eros or Cupid, to, at a particular moment in time, shoot Psyche with one of these arrows that inflames her lust, but only at a moment where Psyche is looking at like the world's grossest human man in order to ruin her life, right? She'll be in love with this man who's atrocious, and this will ruin her life. The problem is that when Eros goes down to do this, he kind of goes down to do a little bit of early work on this, and he visits her in the middle of the night while she's sleeping just to see who she is. And he's got in his hand this candle, and he gazes at her, And while he gazes at her, he's like, damn, she's totally beautiful. And he, again, according to some of these stories, is so enamored with her beauty that he loses track of his arrow and actually pokes himself with an arrow and falls instantly in love with her. Now he snuffs out the candle and wakes her up. And of course, Psyche is like, whoa, who's this guy in my bedroom? But because he's a god, he's able to, with his sweet talking, convince her that he is, a god and that he's in love with her, and he seduces her. Now, the rules of this engagement in this very romantic tale are that Psyche agrees with Eros that he can't make public the fact that they are together. First of all, because his mother will get really pissed off. And second of all, because he is a Greek god, and stories have it that Greek gods are so beautiful that if a mortal woman were to see them full in the light of day, they would kind of be, turned into ash because of their overwhelming godly beauty or something like that. It's one of the reasons you hear over and again that Zeus shows up in the guise of an animal or a cloud or whatever he does to seduce the mortal women. Now, you might be thinking, ladies out there, that this seems pretty, suspect, right? The rule is that Cupid will visit her in the night, but she can never turn on the lights, and they will continue their romantic affair as long as she doesn't look at him. So the story goes like this. She's doing this for a while, but of course, she's so caught up in her love, she wants to share it with someone. And she talks to her sisters about this, and she says to them, hey, you should know I'm totally in love. And they're like, great, who is this person? She says, hey, he's a Greek god. He's visiting me in the night. I can't turn on the lights. And of course, the women are like, you, girl, come on, get some brains here. This doesn't make any sense. We don't believe you. You're being played. Turn on the lights, for crying out loud. And for a while, she resists that temptation, but eventually, after a night where Cupid visits her and he's fallen asleep, she goes over and she lights a candle and she gazes upon him. And when she's gazing upon him, all of her love is confirmed, right? He is the beautiful god. He is everything he said he was, but she's so smitten in this moment, she loses track of the candle and some of the wax drips over and wakes him up. And when he sees her looking at him, he is mortified, right? Now the secret is out, and their romantic love ends then. He can't see her anymore. Now, most of that story isn't here. Most of that story would have been implied. People would have known that story. What this is primarily about is romantic love. It's about two people intertwined, with the focal point being their gaze at one another and their arms interacting with one another. And this beautiful composition, which on the one hand, again, it's a very classical subject, but compositionally is all beautiful, idealized bodies interlocked in this way. Pyramidal, meaning a big pyramid here, it's very stable, very, very much part of the classical tradition, extended by these beautiful wings. It is, by the way, carved out of a couple of pieces of marble. All of this is one piece, and the wings are affixed separately. It's in the Louvre. It's so crystalline and clear, you can actually see through the wings when the light shines between them. And I'll just show you a couple of other views of this. So all about romantic love, all about beauty, all about perfection. But eventually, of course, the tragedy of their departure. If we move back over to the United States, I wanted to show you a French sculptor who created a very controversial sculpture, at least during its time period, of George Washington. This is the work of Jean-Antoine Houdon, who is one of the most famous classical portraitists, at least in terms of sculpture, in France at his own time period. Who was, through the request of Thomas Jefferson, who was the foreign minister of France during the time this was sculpted, invited to come to the United States to create a portrait of our great leader, George Washington. Now, there wasn't much in terms of art in the United States, and the very first forms of art that we start to see show up in the United States happen really around the time of the Revolution. They're almost all these paintings and sculptures of great leaders, in particular George Washington. So Thomas Jefferson, by the way, who was a great devotee of classical ideas, he's fundamentally the reason why most of our governmental buildings look like classical temples, because he believed that those architectures of the Greeks and the Romans were actually embodiments of their values. And by that he meant not just classical values, but Greece's democracy. And of course, we modeled our government on Republican Rome, at least when it comes to Congress, two houses of Congress, the House of Representatives and a Senate. That's taken directly out of Roman culture. He thought that all of these classical works of art embodied their values, and he wanted them in the United States as well. So he asked Houdon to come to the United States and create a sculpture of George Washington that was supposed to be in the Capitol building. But eventually this work was not accepted by Congress. They thought it was too elitist. They didn't like the classical allusions that are in this work. And so now it's in the Virginia State Capitol, where, of course, Thomas Jefferson was governor for a while. So let's go over this for a minute. If you've ever wanted to know what George Washington really looked like, don't look at your dollar bill. This is the face that you want to look at. And the reason for that is that when Houdon came, he created what's called a living mask, or sometimes it's called a death mask, of George Washington by creating a plaster cast of his actual face. So this is the closest accurate record of that face. Now, what he tries to show here is a man who is a great leader, but who isn't caught up with the affectations that are associated with English aristocracy or French aristocracy or anything of that sort. He's dressed kind of like the clothing that he's wearing is, with the exception of the epaulettes on the shoulders that indicate his military standing, he's dressed like a merchant in order to say this is a self-made man. He didn't get born into the world with good breeding and inherit everything he wanted. He worked hard for what he achieved. Furthermore, George Washington in the American public was always understood as being someone who is very much like everyone else, just a little bit better than us. And one of the things that everyone admired about him is that he wasn't affected. He didn't wear wigs, even though his hair looks like it was a wig. And he didn't care much about wearing fancy clothes. And so in order to note that, you can probably barely see this, but if you go down his coat, these buttons are all buttoned until right here, in which George has missed a button there. And that's meant to indicate to the public, he doesn't really care much about what he looks like, right? He cares more about what he does. But the reason that the Senate really disliked this work is, most of you probably know that George Washington didn't want really to be the first president of the United States. After he was, a part of the revolution, he just wanted to go off and farm. He just wanted to have the simple life. And in the United States, farming was the most noble of all ministries. Anything that you could do with your life, farming was one of the best, because it worked in the land and it produced for other people, and it was something that there was no downside to. So this made him very popular. But of course, because we needed him, he agreed not to go to farming initially and served two terms as president, and then later hung up his leadership qualities and returned to farming. And we see that actually represented here. On this weird little bundle that you see, and I'll return to this, you see his sword hung up here, and behind this is the front of a plow, meant to indicate that he is willing to give up power in order to do this noble ministry of farming. The thing that really bothered the senators, though, are a couple of symbols. This bundle of rods here, these rods actually are meant to refer to something that was used in Roman Republican times, before the Romans became an empire. And in Roman Republican times, which was set up as a republic, there were two houses, something that's similar to our House of Representatives and a Senate. And the houses, or rather the representatives for various constituencies in Rome, were given a symbol of their power, which was called the fasces. It's the root word for fascism, although it's not the same thing at all. It's basically a rod that was used to say, I have been elected by my people. This is the symbol of that. And when big votes were needed to be cast in Rome, all of these leaders of the various constituencies in Rome would carry to Rome their fasces as an emblem of their ability to vote for their constituents, and they would bind these things all together, according to some stories, in order to show that while separate, Rome was also unified. Now, because we based our form of government on Republican Rome, Thomas Jefferson and Houdon thought this is a perfect symbol. But the problem was that the American Senate didn't know anything about this history, and so they saw this as elitist. But it fits perfectly. As a matter of fact, I bet you can guess how many rods here. 13 for the original 13 states. The other big emblem you can't see here very well, it's underneath his coat. It's what's known as the badge of Cincinnatus. Cincinnatus was a Roman general who again attained great following through his military exploits, but refused to become an emperor because he didn't think that was the way that Rome should go, and it went off to farm himself. After the revolution, a number of great leaders and soldiers belonged to this order of Cincinnatus on the eastern seaboard in kind of relation to this great Roman leader. Now, George Washington didn't necessarily belong to this, but this was meant to say that just like those great Roman leaders of the past, so George Washington, being offered a leadership role, and he could have had it forever, turned it down because that was what was better for the United States. But again, these were types of, what we call in art history iconography or symbols that the Senate didn't know anything about. And frankly, governmental leaders don't like to be told they don't know things. And basically, there was a lot of infighting with Thomas Jefferson and so forth. And so they refused to have this sculpture in Congress, and it ended up in Virginia's state capitol. So if they didn't like that one, you can imagine what happened when they saw this one. This is another, this in this case, we've got an American artist. We'll see him come back later on. Just show you this very briefly. This is a work by Horatio Greenough of George Washington. And if you're looking at this like, holy crap, what's going on here? It's the same idea. We see the great leader and his face, but his face is put on an idealized, perfect body. For the same reason that we've covered in classicism, right? George Washington is good and he's true. Therefore, according to the classical tradition, you represent him idealized, this perfect body, because it's godlike. He is like God, perfect. You represent him in a toga as well, right? Because this is what is a classical artist does. It makes him timeless rather than in contemporary clothes, which would locate them in this specific moment in time. But of course, if they weren't willing to accept Houdon's work, they hated this work. This was not the George Washington that they had in mind. We'll end with this one. And I just want to reference this because next week, when we come back and we start looking at a kind of change in style. It moves from classicism up until romanticism. We start to see more and more in the 19th century representations of the female nude, which is a very standard subject in the history of art and comes with its own philosophy, which I'll give you a little indication of this time and then pick up next time. What I want to say about this is a work by Hiram Power called The Greek Slave. And in the United States, although in Europe there was this really strong tradition of the female nude, which made it okay to represent women without their clothing on because, well, in short, people thought saw the female nude in the same way they saw the male nude, or at least they said they did, which is beauty, whether it be male or female, puts us in God's image. Thus, representing the perfect, beautiful female nude is completely okay because it's not about sex, it's not about eroticism, it's about representing beauty per se and bringing us into contemplation of the classical tradition and the divine and so forth. in the United States, we didn't have that tradition. We were a much younger culture. And so, because frankly, we're a little bit prudish in the United States as well, the tradition of the female nude was just not accepted. People said, no, that's a woman without her clothes on. This is the opposite of what we want. This is something teaching people to be, too sexual, too erotic, to think of women the wrong way. And I'm not saying they had it wrong. They just didn't come from the same tradition, so they didn't accept it in the same way. There were paintings brought in that you'll see going forward that weren't accepted, that worked really well when they're shown in the English and French Royal Academies, right up until this time period. When Hiram Powers created this work, one of the kind of brilliant things that he did was he associated this with a political issue that was very consuming for the American public. You see, at this time period, and what this is meant to refer to is that the Greeks in the early, well, frankly, starting in the 18th century and into the early 19th century, were seeking their independence from the great Ottoman Turkish Empire. And they were in these wars of revolution against them. And many, many times the Turks, and wars are horrible things, did horrible things to the Greeks, including enslaving children and women, and sometimes even selling these women into sexual slavery. So these stories were coming out, and of course, everyone in Western Europe, seeing Greece as the starting point for Western civilization, saw this as a cause that they wanted to support. We want the Greeks to gain their independence. It didn't hurt as well that the Ottoman Turks, of course, were Muslim and thus were seen by a primarily Christian Western Europe as infidels or as pagans, and the Greeks were Orthodox Christian. So with this raging and with abolitionist movements rising in the United States, Hiram Powers realized that if he depicted a scene of a beautiful classical woman in chains, as if she were standing on an auction block being sold off into sexual slavery, he could, on the one hand, sculpt a work that was in the classical tradition, and on the other hand, get it accepted by an American public that was kind of allergic to the nude, at least when it came to nude women in art in America. And he accompanied this work by numerous pamphlets, including the one that you see here now. As you see, he explained it. Here you have this great work, it comes from the classical tradition, as it says here, and I'll just read it in case you can't read it. The Grecian maiden has been made captive by the Turks and exposed for sale in a bazaar in Constantinople. Constantinople, by the way, is modern day Istanbul. The statue is the property of Mr. Powers, who's basically trying to alert us to the problems of what's going on in Europe. Right? So the American public really liked this, but I don't want you to think that they only liked it because somehow it made us think about the plight of the Greeks. After all, stop and think about this for a minute. If in America, Americans were a little bit allergic, or let's say suspicious of the representation of nudity because it might be sexualized. In this case, that story that went along with it was kind of like a cover story that allowed them, this is the argument I want to make anyway, that allowed them to have the same pleasure of looking at a beautiful and frankly really objectified woman while still feeling like it was okay because after all, it's the Turks who are doing this to the women, not us, right? We don't treat our women this way. Or another way to put this is you could look at a depiction of this beautiful nude woman and be okay doing it because, after all, this is condemning the treatment of women in this way. And the reason that I come to that interpretation, that it is a little bit of a cover story, is look at her carefully. Imagine yourself, I don't care if you're a man or a woman, being stripped nude and sold off into sexual slavery on an auction block. Would you look like this? Would you act like this? Would you try to cover yourself up, perhaps? And even more importantly, a couple of things. What you're looking at here now, juxtaposed against her, is one of the other copies of this from the back that was turned into a stereoscopic image, which was One of the earliest ways we use photography basically to create erotic images. They're kind of like those little viewfinders that kids have today where you look through them and it makes everything look more 3D. This is early erotica, and they used this sculpture in erotic ways. And they wouldn't allow men and women in to view the sculpture at the same time. There are different viewing periods for each sex as well. That's just an introduction to some of the complexities of the female nude. We'll pick these up again when we come back next week and start looking at later versions of neoclassicism into the Romantic period and look at the thorny question of the female nude. I hope you enjoyed this week. I look forward to an entire quarter with you. And until next week, I'll see you.